All around us, people are battling addictions in many forms. Every day in the U.S., 2,500 youth abuse a prescription pain reliever for the first time. About 6.5 million people from 12 to 20 admit to being binge drinkers. Over 6 million children in America live with at least one parent who has a drug addiction. 6 to 8% of Americans are sex addicts, which is 18 to 24 million people. 70% of 18 to 24-year-old men visit pornographic websites in a typical month. 1 out of every 6 women is addicted to pornography. All around us, people need to be set free. There are many programs that help people to overcome their addictions. Teen Challenge is one of these programs. Teen Challenge is a faith-based behavioral and mental health counseling program that has been helping people find freedom from their addictions for over 53 years.
Greater Piedmont Teen Challenge has been in existence since 1975. Started off in Burlington, North Carolina in a rented, borrowed house. Moved to a school in Whitsett and then finally landed in a college campus here in Greensboro. We've been here over 30 years, helping men with life-controlling problems. This is a faith-based ministry, Greater Piedmont Teen Challenge. And we're excited because this marks over 50 years we've been in existence in the month of February. Started in 1958 by David Wilkerson. David Wilkerson was a country preacher from southern Pennsylvania. And he is in a small country church, and he started reading the news, newspapers, and magazines. Saw some teenage gang members were having troubles in New York City, particularly a group that had beat a kid to death in Central Park, and he went and tried to intervene on their behalf. He was never able to help those kids, but God called him to start this international ministry called Teen Challenge, starting off with gang members, then helping adults as well. And that's grown to 1,100 teen challenge centers around the world. And any one day, there's 19,000 people in teen challenge. Or we can use the example of the AA, for example. A very good model, a model to try to help people, a 12-step model. Originally, that model was designed by the Oxford Revival Movement. And that was to lead people to a deeper walk with Christ. And so some of the founders of AA thought they would just make it more generic and took the scriptures out. But it's still effective because of the biblical principles. That's why Teen Challenge is effective, because of the biblical principles. We're here to share the love of Christ with people, show them that Jesus, a personal relationship with Christ, will give you a purpose and a direction in your life, and then to help them to grow, young men, ages 18 to 45 in our particular location.
There's a lot of guys right now that are getting into over-the-counter pills. And to get there, they have to steal. They don't have the funds to make these purchases, so they start to steal from their families. And so when the parents first contact us, they're telling us about lying and stealing and all these things. And either they have discovered that the young man is doing drugs or they're about to. And that is heartbreaking when a young man comes to us and they just think that he's, you know, got all these troubles with lying and stealing and all of those. And on the day that he comes into Teen Challenge and takes a drug test, they find out that he's doing Oxycontin or he's doing some other sort of drugs that he's getting, either prescription or otherwise. And that is a tangled mess. And as far as the ones that kind of self-identify, they're very self-aware of the addiction, the ones that are taking those drugs seem to be the ones that are most brokenhearted over their situation. We have parents that call us with their sons, and the son has done the research and found Teen Challenge because they know they're in trouble. And I would say, this is a part of the question, but I would say listen to those cries for help because they're real. And these guys need help. What our children need is strong boundaries. they desire it, and they really don't know how to ask for it. They don't know how to put it down on paper, and they would never say to a parent, what I really want are more rules for my life. But children feel safer when they have very clear boundaries. And we've had young men in the time that I've been here who've been brought by their parents, and they're told what time to get up, how long to take a shower, what time lunch and breakfast and supper are. They're told all of these things. One of the greatest benefits of Teen Challenge is being taught how to live. And they learn those routines, and it's a relief to them because they don't have to think about it.
The first thing is to know that we do love our child with all our heart, but that there is one up there that loves them more of what we do love them. And if God is putting in their heart to bring the boys here, that is the right thing to do. They will find Jesus here. They will find structure here also. Discipline with grace. Communication is very important. Something that I do teach them, and I want when they graduate the program, I hope they get, is that they always have to say the truth, no matter how bad it is. Come to the parents, come to mom, to that older brother maybe, and let them trust them. And they will know that they have a discipline, but they can trust them with whatever. Communication is so important.
I've seen guys come in here that were physically sick as well as mentally sick. Some of them couldn't even come out right away because they had to go in and detox a little before they could even come out. And, you know, the last thing they knew or remember is being out on the street living just about anywhere. But then they come in here and they find a new life. They come meet brothers who are Christian or who are learning about the Lord. Didn't know Him, but learning about Him. And then you start seeing the change. And little bit by little bit, the change comes about. And I've seen one guy we have here, and I hope he don't mind me saying something about him, but he was in the program, graduated the program, went back to school, and earned a degree, and came out of college magna cum laude. He did an excellent job, and now he's, you know, of course, looking for another job opportunity, but he's on the staff with us full time now. And the program did that. And a lot of guys go out and they do very well. And of course, you know, every now and then we have somebody that doesn't do quite as well. And as God would have it, they are able to come back in the program, go through it again, and do very well. So I think it's a great, this is one of the best job for me. I don't call it a job, I call it a ministry, because people come in this store every day, and it's somebody who's hurting, somebody whose heart is broken or whatever. Like a lady came in the other day, and she comes in all the time, and I spoke to her, and she said, hey, how you doing? I said, what's wrong? Nothing. She said, I said, no, your mouth is saying nothing, but your heart is saying something. Like, what's wrong? She said, well, my father passed away 2 or 3 days ago, I think she said. She said, and I just needed to get out, and I didn't know what to say to her. So I asked her, can I have a hug? And she just broke down and started crying. Sometimes that's all they need in here. Sometimes they come in and just want to be in the midst of everybody here.
I myself was a addict myself for over 20 years, and I struggled with alcohol and drug addiction for over 20 years. And I came here back in 1998 to at a point in my life where I was broken and just hurting and tired of living the way I was, and had attempted suicide and it didn't work. So I came here to this program in 98 and found Christ here at Teen Challenge, and He came into my life and began to change my heart from inside out. And through that relationship with Him, I was able to overcome the problems that I had in life and start a relationship with Him. Just to be able to see the guys' countenance on their face, where you can see the hopelessness. You can see that hopelessness the day they come in the door. or the moment I talked to them on the phone. And then to see them come to the program and to see these guys maybe even after a chapel service or maybe talking to one of the dorm staff in the dorm, and you might see them the next day and then you see a smile on their face. And you just know that the Holy Spirit has touched that person's life, and you see that joy in their life for the first time. And you see that freedom in their life for the first time, and that's what I really love to see here, man.
The way we do worship service, we come in here and we always pray first, and we always ask the Holy Spirit to show up, because we can't do anything without the Holy Spirit and praise and worship. And we don't force guys to praise God. We don't make them do it no certain way. But it's just something about when we're in this chapel or whatever church we go to, when God begins to tug at your heart, it's just something in you. You just have to praise God. And that's what we try to do here at Teen Challenge. We just try to lead the young men. Some men have never been to church before. Some of them never heard how to praise and worship or what is praise and worship. And we just show them by leading by example. And what I mean by that, we just come in here and say, hey, I'm going to spend time with God. This is how I praise God. You're going to praise God a totally different way. So that's how we do praise and worship. You know what? It is amazing to me when we go to court with these young men, just like Alberto. And when we tell them that he's at Teen Challenge, it looks like something just switch on to the judge. And the judge is like, okay. Because it looks like to me, they already know about Teen Challenge. They know everything about it. And when you say Teen Challenge, it's like a light clicks on in their head. They're like, okay, you're in a great place. We want you to finish that program. Do not leave that program. You know, we want to hear back from you in 7 months from now.
My name is Gail Waddle. I went through Teen Challenge in 2004, 2005. I started out in Hot Springs, Arkansas. Did the first 5 months of the program is introductory to Teen Challenge, and I went through that. After that, the induction part, I went to Cape Girardeau, Missouri, where I did 10 months and finished the program at Cape Girardeau. I was a 30-year cocaine addict and lived on the streets and did a lot of bad things, hurt a lot of people. But then I came to Teen Challenge in 2004, and it was hard to complete the program, but I did it. And after I did, God just put a yearning in my heart to help others. And I've been with Teen Challenge ever since. I'll tell you, I found early on by working with Teen Challenge, anybody can go around quoting the Bible, anybody, but you gotta show it. You gotta work with them. You gotta let them know that you love them by doing things for them, by working with them. And you know, I try to greet them every morning. I'm the wake up guy here. I wake up every morning. I try to, you know, get them motivated, and you know, instead of just rushing them and being hard. Sometimes you have to be hard because you know of the group that we deal with. But you know, but you just show them love, and for the most part, when you show love, you receive love.
We know that God has our best interests at heart. He wants the best for us. He wants something better than we want for our own selves. And I know that at the age that these guys are at, they've got hopes and dreams, plans for a career and family and education. All these plans are inside their heart. And what I'm about to say is easy to say and hard to do, but take all that stuff that you dreamed up for yourself and just set it aside. And pray as a blank slate and allow the Holy Spirit to give you a new plan and a new vision and a new hope for your life. His is better than anything you can dream up for yourself. And so he's going to make sure that we're doing the things that allow us to be spared. And Teen Challenge is part of that ministry. A lot of guys see this as a punitive season of life, that they're being punished because they made these bad decisions. On some level, that's probably true. You know, it's my hope that less and less guys need Teen Challenge, but the reality is it doesn't have to be jail or pre-jail or anything that's like that. What it can be is a springboard for the next stage of life. Guys leave Teen Challenge able to make good decisions. And I want, at the word that I want to get out about Teen Challenge is, if I were an employer looking for solid employees and you put, I was a student at Mid-Atlantic Teen Challenge on there, I would hire you. I would allow a graduate of Mid-Atlantic Teen Challenge to be a candidate to marry my daughter. I believe in the ministry here. And I would put what I've got on the line for someone who's graduated from this program.
Dr. Chad Costantino is a Christian counselor in Kernersville, North Carolina, and is the founder of Abundant Life Ministries. He frequently counsels families dealing with addictions and often speaks in youth assemblies about the dangers of addiction.
And so we live in a world where people, they're hurting. We're all a bunch of actors. We all say we're fine. We lie all the time. None of us are fine. We're hurting. We need each other. We need the love of God. We need the grace of God every day, the love of the body of Christ. One of the reasons that I believe God tells us to love Him and love each other so much is because that love is what keeps most people going, because they're so hurting.
Pat, I'm going to talk to you about several things, and I'm going to do it quick because our time's going to fly by. It's going to fly by. I do need to let you know that, yes, I may be a doctor. I have a PhD in counseling. I work with boys and girls and men all week, well, Monday through Thursday, who battle with anger, depression, addictions, anxiety. Maybe they've lost someone. But I need you to know that to be successful in life doesn't mean that you're always going to be perfect, always going to make the right decisions. As a matter of fact, I'm going to be telling you some personal things about me today. All right? One of the things I'm going to tell you is that I'm a recovered addict. I made a lot of bad choices in my past and got involved in a lot of drugs and made a lot of bad decisions. But then, God helped, made the right decisions. Now I'm passionate about trying to help boys and girls all over to not make some of the same bad decisions that I've made in my past. In life, you're going to make decisions, and some of those decisions are going to be the wrong decisions. As a matter of fact, every day, every moment of the day, you're making choices. Your brain is processing choices all day long, all week long. When you, some of those choices you make will be the wrong choice. And at that moment, it is a defining moment in your life. For example, let's say you fail a class or fail a test, and you feel like you've fallen down, you've messed up. You can decide, you can cross your arms and say, I'm a failure, I messed up, I'm never going to do good again. Or you can decide to get up and to learn from your mistake. Or maybe you talked back to a teacher or talked back to your parent or got in trouble with the law or got in trouble at school or at home, and you made a mistake and you fell down. Or maybe somebody knocked you down. Maybe your best friend just did something to really hurt you or knock you down. Or a boyfriend or a girlfriend hurt your feelings and knocked you down. Or somebody you trusted in life hurt you and knocked you down. At that moment, you have to make a choice. And that's a defining moment in your life. What will you do? Will you get up or will you stay down? What will you do? Get up, she says she'll get up. Let's cheer it on. Y'all give her a cheer. Come on up.
Lucy, it's Lewis, right? Have you ever wore a pair of handcuffs before?
Holy Spirit. Please don't. Okay, please don't. But I want you to see what it feels like to be in a pair of handcuffs. Miss Brown, can you
says, all things work for the good of those who love the Lord and are called according to His purpose. And I love Him, and I have done some junk in my past. I have hurt a lot of people, and I have done a lot of shameful things. But I want you to know that my God took all that. He flipped it. Because He loves me. When I am unfaithful, He is faithful. When I don't love Him, He still loves me. When I deny Him, He does not deny me. You know, I have done things I shouldn't have done. I understand Paul's struggle, where Paul says in Romans 7, 24 and 25, he says, what a wretched sinner I am. Who will save me from this life of sin? This is the Apostle Paul. This is a man who wrote 13 books of the Bible, 13 books. And he struggled. He said, the things I don't want to do, I do. The things I don't want to do, I keep on doing. The sin within me that I don't want to give into, I keep giving into. But yet this man, he understood that through Christ, there is no condemnation. None. There are so many people that have done so many wretched things and they think that they're condemned to hell. No, they're not. Do you know most people don't even realize that a third of the Bible was written by murderers? That Moses, who wrote the first 5 books of the Bible, he was a murderer? But God redeemed him. That David, who wrote books of the Bible, he was an adulterer and a murderer, and God redeemed him. That Paul, who wrote 13 books of the Bible, he used to be a man named Saul, and Saul had Christians tortured, imprisoned, and killed. God is a redeemer. But people don't know this. They don't know that the strongest man in the Bible, Samson, and the most passionate man in the Bible, King David, and the wisest man in the Bible, King Solomon, all three fell to sexual immorality. But yet God, He did discipline them. He did. He disciplined all these people. But He loved them and He restored them and He forgave them. And He wants to do the same thing for you and me.
Life of 14 Challenge, it was a disaster. I was at the point where I couldn't go on without my day, without substances, without having something in my body, something that would basically take me out of reality. I spent a lot of my time by myself in my room. I actually got diagnosed with depression at the time and just felt like no one really felt what I was going through. I felt alone. I just felt worthless at the time.
My Life of 14 Challenge was very chaotic. At 16, I just started pouring out, just doing multiple drugs. Feelings I felt inside, you know, prior before I came here was just insecurity, loneliness, fear of failure, a lot of anger too. Like lack of self-control contributed to that feeling also.
We took the young man here at Teen Challenge to a horse farm in Smithfield, which is about 30 minutes from the center here. Mr. Steve showed us how even the most reckless of creatures and one that's running completely wild could then become a very productive creature. He talked to us about self-control. He talked to us about trust. And it was those lessons that I could tell were really hitting home for the young men today.
It was definitely pretty funny, like, getting there, because, like, it was just in the middle of nowhere and we didn't know where we were going. So that part was interesting. And I liked how they just followed him around. Like, he talked to us for, like, some, like, half an hour, and one horse didn't move at all. Just stayed there the whole time.
I really loved how he showed us, you know, how to have self-control, how to just to be able to trust others and to be able to trust myself.
Well, I just thought it was so cool how the horse trusted Steve today. He built up that trust with the horse, and that's so relevant to real life.
I really enjoyed it. It's pretty great. I definitely want to go again.
Mr. Steve, I want to give you this book.
Well, thank you.
Enjoy that. Thank you.
I will.
Can we give a hand for a good job? The signature of success. For Teen Challenge, the signature of success means that this is a quality program that sets up young men to be successful for the rest of their lives. We're motivated by the love of God at Teen Challenge. Here in the center, it's part of everything we do is to lead these young men to a place where they can trust God with their whole lives.
I guess especially last 3-4 months of my life before I came were just completely, it felt like my life was falling apart. Like pretty much all the other guys that come here, I really didn't think I needed to be here. In the end, I'm glad that I'm here, even though it's not the most fun thing, you know. It's called Teen Challenge for a purpose. Now I feel like my life is coming back together, and it's good. And no matter how much I was able to destroy, everything still is coming back together.
My name is Mark Timothy Wallace. I currently live in Wilmington, North Carolina. I came here to Teen Challenge about 3 weeks ago. You know, I came here in a lot different circumstance than a lot of these young men that come through this place. I'm in a much different place in my walk with Christ as a lot of these young men. And I've come to find that I'm not really here so much for my addictions, but for the discipleship itself. These grounds here that God has set apart and ordained to bring these young men to Him and go out in this world as those lights on a hill, you know, to lead their family and eventually the whole world back into the kingdom that He's meant this place to be. This is my training ground before I go back out there in the world and do the Lord's work. It's been a true blessing seeing what he's done in my life here, and even just the past 3 weeks. And I would have never imagined. I would have never imagined what happened already. But it actually all started with a little girl in my church that's 13 years old that just came up to me and told me about Teen Challenge about 2 months before I came here. You know, I kind of looked at her like she was crazy at the time. But, you know, here I am. Here I go. You know, there's no stopping me now. There's nothing that can stop me. I'm gonna go wherever the Lord takes me and just proclaim His truth. I hope everybody's heart's ready to hear it, because it's coming. The flesh of their flesh might also be mine. wife against husband and son against son is the tactic I'll use until I have won. I can't get them all, but I can have some. I'm already condemned. This is all just for fun. Now this is a story of New, how he's brought his destruction upon me and you, how he's tricked and deceived us from the days of our youth. Now guys, pay attention. Christ gave me this truth. I'll show them a world without you. I'll use them as vessels and they'll have no clue. I'll make them my soldiers and they'll be my strength. I'll conquer their minds and control how they think. I'll busy their brains with this thing and that, so they won't even notice when I attack. But how can I do this? What tools can I use? I'll bewitch them with melodies and words like a muse. With song, I'll cast spells and make war with their heart. But they'll not even know it, though it shall pierce like a dart. I'll give them some movies. What harm can they be? But I'll fill them with things they can't even see. I'll make up elixirs and give them to drink. Man, this tastes good is all they will think. And if they'll drink my elixirs and not even know, I wonder how far they'll be willing to go. I'll trick them with potions to lather their skin, but they'll not even know how deep it sinks in. I'll hex them with curses attached or invite to the pills that they take day, noon, and night. I'll poison the waters from which they will drink. Then it will be easy to change how they think.
My name is Craig Smith. I'm currently at Greater Piedmont Teen Challenge in Greensboro, North Carolina, and I'm 20 years old. I've come to realize that throughout my life, I constantly was trying to find myself through the creation, through man-made things and through the world. But I became known and I thought I could find myself through the reputation I had, through the money I had, through the possessions I had, but the creation can never find itself in the creation. I've come to realize that I can only find myself through the one who made me, through the Creator. There's really three words that I can describe my life as. And you know, before I found the Lord, I was broken, I was lost, and I was hopeless. I was searching and trying to find meaning and purpose through all the wrong reasons and through all the wrong places in life. And I ended up more broken and in more pain than I had ever experienced. I ended up more in bondage than when I started. I'm 20 years old and I've already done 28 and a half months in prison. You know, and the thing is, I went down a very deep and dark path, but I know that the God that I serve, He used it for good. You know, I was searching after pleasure, but the one thing that I've come to realize about pleasure is the more that you seek after it, the more intensely you chase it, the less likely you are to catch it. My joy and my happiness isn't through the world, isn't through getting high, isn't through the things that I have or the car that I have or anything like that. My joy comes from the Lord now. I lost my dad while I was in prison. We had a terrible relationship, and it was one of the hardest things that I had ever gone through. But he died of mesothelioma. And it was a difficult time in my life, and I had nobody to turn to but the Lord. And He used something that was so dark, and just so many people look at it as bad for good. He used it to open my eyes and help me to realize what truly mattered in life. I went and saw my dad with shackles on my wrists, shackles on my ankles, locked up, and I didn't know what to say. The only thing that I could say, the only prayer that I could pray was, Lord, I don't understand, but I cannot carry this burden. I need you. I need you to guide me, I need you to direct me, and just use this for your benefit. And He's done that beyond anything that I could ever have asked. I sit here today a new creation. I mean, to sit here and think that I would be serving the Lord a year and a half, 2 years ago from now, never. I never would have thought that. You know, but that just shows you how awesome the God is that I serve. I have a plan and a purpose now in my life that is more fulfilling, more rewarding than anything that money could give me or sex or anything like that. I know that I have a plan and a purpose from the Lord, and I'm embracing the talents, gifts, and abilities that I have now from the Lord. I like to look at it as I used to follow blindly along in darkness, but now I'm that light shining bright within the darkness. You know, Jesus tells us to be a lamp, to be a light to the world, and that's what I'm doing. And it's not for my glory, but it's for His. Because without Him, apart from Him, I can do nothing. I tried it. I tried my way and it ended up being a prison. I was broken. I was hopeless. I was lost. I had lost everything that I had. But I know that it happened so that I could realize that Jesus Christ was the only one that I needed. I just let His Spirit lead me every day. You know, I have this passion in my heart and this love like I've never experienced and this joy that I've never experienced in my life. And restoration is being brought throughout my family and throughout my life. And it's just all the glory belongs to Him. The biggest thing that I have to realize and remember is how bad things got when I tried to do it on my own. I wake up every morning, I have a picture of my mugshot so I never forget. So I never forget how bad it got when I tried to do it my way. I'm just so thankful that I can actually sit here today and think so reminded and be aware. You know, to be able to pour into people's lives and have lives change, but it's not me, it's just the Spirit using me. And that's more rewarding than any job, than any amount of money you can make. That's more rewarding than anything in the world. And I finally found that purpose and that meaning. To a lot of people, I was known as a thief and a drug dealer, a drug addict, somebody that wasted their potential and wouldn't amount to anything. But now I know that I'm a child of God. Now I know that there's something out in the distance that I can't see, but I know that God has something in store and wants to use me to touch somebody. I don't know what it is, but I told the Lord when I went to prison the last time, I said, wherever you want me to go, whatever you want me to do, I'm going to do it. And I meant that with all my heart, and I'm not going back to that life. I can't. Because I know that I'm going to either end up dead or I'm going to end up in prison. And he paid it all for me. So I owe all to Him. And that's just the bottom line. I sat here and I came in and I was broken. I mean, I cried out to the Lord in prison, but it's a place of preparation and a place of training where we're building up Christians and we're building up soldiers for God's army. Because you can't just expect to go out there and follow the Lord without training and preparation. Even Paul himself went away for years after he got saved and prepared. And that's exactly what I think Teen Challenge does. Teen Challenge doesn't save people, it's Jesus using Teen Challenge. Because we need this discipleship, we need this structure, we need this discipline in our life so that we can not only grow closer to the Lord, but so we can be prepared for the calling that He has on each and every one of our lives. I would just let them know that I'm sorry for the heartache that I caused them. And just let them know how much I love them, how much I appreciate everything He did for me, because even when I turned my back on Him, He still loved me and He was still there for me. And He deserved a better son. And I'm sorry that He couldn't be here to see it, but you know, God has transformed me and that I love Him. And I miss Him a lot. You know, but I know that one day we'll be reunited in heaven. I think about you always, Dad. I love you and I miss you so much. And nobody could ever replace you in my life. And everything that you taught me, the morals you tried to instill in me, it wasn't in vain, because you planted a seed at a young age, and now you're beginning to see that seed bloom into a beautiful tree of life. And I can't thank you enough for that, Dad.
My name is Chris Johnson. I am 23 years old. I am the cook/tech. How I got connected with Teen Challenge, I'm a graduate. I graduated Teen Challenge of April 7th of 2011. I was a drug and alcohol addict, and I gave my heart to the Lord at a graduation of April 1st of 2010. And I have experienced miracles, changes in my family and in my life too. I give God the glory. You know, God has put me into this ministry to reach out to these boys, you know, to be able to, you know, cook their meals every day, you know, to be able to just devote my life into their lives, you know, by spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ into their lives. That means, you know, I pray over the meal, you know, I ask God, what is it that you want me to cook for these boys? You know, what can I do different? You know, what can I, you know, be able to make their food taste better? It's all about, you know, giving them the flavor, you know, showing them the love that, you know, and the compassion of my heart into their meals every day. Well, the advice I'd give a parent is that, you know, to trust in God, that there's godly influential in through this building, that, you know, that God is using us to be able to show them the love that they've never experienced before, you know, through the gospel, you know, and you know, and then showing them different types of meals, you know, that we provide here, you know, and they could take that home and, you know, show their parents of, you know, what they've learned since they've been here. Well, I'd ask God, is this of you, you know, is this the right place, you know, and be able to surround myself with people that care, you know, that are loving and kind, you know, to them. Well, God wants me to be able to start Bethel College here in Hampton, hopefully in the fall time. I want to be able to hopefully, get credentialed as Assembly of God pastor / missionary and be able to go overseas and open up Teen Challenge centers for kids that, you know, that don't know the Lord, you know, in rough areas, you know, be able to take the gospel where it's not even been, you know, talked about and just show them, you know, because there's, you know, I don't want to go into a part where, you know, the gospel's already been spread. I want to, you know, go into different places, you know, places where, you know, people are getting persecuted, you know, be able to stand up for what is right, you know, what the truth is, you know, to be able to be led by the Holy Spirit.
The drug that I was using that brought me here to Teen Challenge was prescription painkillers. I remember about 2 years ago, I got prescribed hydrocodone, which is a painkiller, and right at that moment that I took Satan attacked me. And he put into my mind that this is what is going to help you when you're hurting. You know, this is the thing that you'll be able to depend on when you're upset. You know, he put in my mind that it's okay to abuse painkillers and everything will be okay. So before I came to Teen Challenge, I was actually leading worship at my home church, and as dealing with pride, I feel like my music a lot of the time was performing instead of leading people to worship. Coming here to Teen Challenge, getting away from the distractions of the outside world and just really focusing in on what God wants for me, I feel like he's taken a lot of that performing and put it into more of a talent to give glory to him, and I slowly feel like my music, writing music, everything is just catching on fire. So
testimony is by the grace of God. I grew up in a regular family. I have one littler sister. My parents were together, and things were just going great for me. I was playing baseball. I was playing baseball 3 seasons out of 4, getting good grades, A's and B's, and just doing everything. Just doing everything right. About second grade, my parents divorced, and at first it didn't really faze me until my later years. When I was a freshman. Kind of started to hit me. I started dating here and there, and things were starting to hurt me. So I decided to, you know, to dip my foot into smoking marijuana. I started smoking, and I liked what it did, and I liked just the fact of doing it, you know. I thought it was cool. So I smoked for a few months, and then I had a friend introduce me to alcohol. Alcohol was my love, if you could say, at the time. I would drink bottles at a time. At first, it just started, you know, drinking with my friends, just getting drunk, you know, having a good time for what I thought was a good time. And then it got to the point where I was drinking every other night by myself in my room. It was horrible. And then about 10th grade, I got a girlfriend. We started getting pretty serious, you know, and she didn't know about my drinking. She didn't know anything that was going on behind the scenes, and I would keep a secret from her. Until I started dipping my foot into pills. I found pills. I was looking through my mom's purse and I found some Adderall. I began to take Adderall, you know, 30, 40 milligrams at a time. I wouldn't sleep a night or two, wouldn't eat for a day. You know, not that big of a deal, but I thought. And then it got to the point where I was mixing alcohol and pills together. I was drinking, taking Adderall, taking Xanax, and just filling my body with all these chemicals, and losing sleep, and I just wasn't eating. And it was just horrible. I just wasn't the same person. My junior year, about a little over a year ago, I was on the baseball team, you know, still doing all right. My parents had some suspicion of what I was doing, and I was still dating this girl, you know, and I found out one night that she had been cheating on me. So that night I decided I was going to kill myself. I have a deathly peanut allergy, and I went home, you know, and just called me. I wrote my mom a note and told her, you know, exactly what I was feeling. I was upset what my girlfriend had done to me. I was upset what my best friend had done to me. And so I just decided to eat a Snickers bar and fall asleep. About 20 minutes later, I woke up, you know, gasping for breath. We had to call the ambulance, and they rushed me to the hospital. That night, my life was saved. I was on the verge of dying. And I stayed in the hospital for about a week. Got out of the hospital, and still found out that this girl was cheating on me. So one day at school, me and the girl were separated. I was walking down the hallway and saw her with another guy, my former best friend. And I went up to him, and just very impulsively, I struck him across the face. One punch, he went to the ground, and I got on top of him and began hitting him. And you know, it took a couple of the football players to get me off. And when they got me off, you know, I got sent down to the office, and I got suspended for a week. And this got me put onto probation. So I was on probation, still using the pills, still using the alcohol for about a few weeks into probation. I was failing drug tests. I failed like 3 or 4 drug tests, went to court, and this looked horrible. So I knew I couldn't use pills anymore. I couldn't use them as much as I was. So I began using inhalants, and I began using over-the-counter dextromorphine. I was abusing these substances that aren't meant to be abused. I was taking almost 20 times as much as you should be for regular pills, and it was literally killing brain cells. It was just making me a zombie to reality. So one day I was in study hall, and in my study hall, the tables are coordinated by our last names, and I'm sitting in study hall with my sister, and I reach into my book bag, and I get cleaning supplies out, and beginning inhaling it. You know, I was totally oblivious to everything that was going on. I could care less what my sister thought. I could care less where I'm at in my life. I just needed that next high. And I began inhaling it. And they caught it on camera, told my probation officer, and I got sent to juvie. Well, I sat in juvie for about 2 weeks, and I thought, you know, this is where I'm going to be for a couple months. This is where I'm going to be. So I went to court. They told me, you know, you got a little over a year in juvie for breaking all your, breaking probation so many times and just doing all these things. So I thought I was done, you know. I thought I was going to be sitting in jail and only looking forward to getting out and going back to using. Well, my mom found Teen Challenge, and that was really just great. I came to Teen Challenge open to what God wanted me to do, and that was really by God's grace, because, you know, I could come in fighting the program and just not wanting to change, but I wanted to change. So my first month, second month, it was rough getting in, but about third, fourth month, I started getting with the program. I started doing what I knew I needed to do. I got closer to God, and that was the most important thing, is I began reading my Bible. I began doing devotions almost every single night, and I just began getting in tune with God, and it felt great. I've been 9 months clean now, and I wouldn't go back. I can't wait to graduate the program, and I'm not rushing it, you know? I'm happy to speak to God every day and to just do what He has for my life. So I thank God for everything He's doing in my life, and I thank the Teen Challenge for everything they've done for my life.
It's like God give us that little leeway, that favor, because it's just amazing to me when you mention Teen Challenge. Every judge, every lawyer, everyone knows about Teen Challenge. And it's like God just give us favor. And I think that's what God did. But I know that's what God did with Alberto. Showed him favor in that court. When we went to court the first time for Alberto, and the district attorney started reading off all his charges. And a couple of his charges was hitting police officers. And when he got to that, the judge began to shake his head. And that's when the lady finished, the judge said, okay, did you bring your toothbrush? And then Alberto was standing side by side up there. And we looked at each other, he said, well, what I'm trying to tell you that I always send people to jail. Anyone who put their hands on my police officers, no questions asked. And as he was saying that, one officer was coming around to Alberto's side. And the judge said, well, I'm gonna go ahead and hear you. And I was there to represent Alberto, just to help him out and speak for Teen Challenge. And I began to tell the judge that, Your Honor, the man that you hear, that's hear all the charges, that's true, he did all those things. But I tell you now that the man standing before you is not the same man. And the only way he has changed his life is through Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ came in and changed this man's life. He hasn't had any anger problems, any outbursts or anything. But it's through Jesus Christ that changed his life. And if you put him in jail, then that's not going to help him more at all. But if you let him come back and finish Teen Challenge, God can finish his work in his life. And that's when the judge looked at him and said, I have never did this in 35 years, but you're not going to jail. And it blew everybody away in the courtroom. The courtroom got silent because they just wanted to see how much time he would actually get. Even his probation officer told him, you're probably going to get 75 days, most likely, if not more. And we walked out of that courtroom with nothing. And it was just amazing what God had done. And I told Alberto, I'm pretty sure the judge is probably scratching his head right now, like, no, I never did that. So that's how God works. So that was amazing to have the opportunity to see that.
Well, for the first time in a long time, when I go to sleep at night, I felt I could go to sleep when he wasn't home. Before, I'd be worried about what he was doing or where he was, but I always felt at peace knowing that he was here and that he was in the arms of God. I've seen my son turn into a man. What brought him here was prescription drugs from football, from when he was in high school. So since he was a junior in high school, off and on for the majority of every single year, he's had a surgery, and they've kept him on medication. And then the last year, he had another surgery and had all the screws and everything taken from his leg, but he just wasn't getting any better, and they had put another screw in. And he had a blood infection. But on top of that, he was addicted to the medications that they had had him on for all the years. And he always had a personal relationship with God, but he always felt like there was more. He wanted more. He always wanted more. And when this happened, I couldn't help him. His friends couldn't help him. So he felt to God, and through Jesus Christ, God helped him and brought him here. You told him about this place, and he called and basically begged them to take him. And he was so humble and in such a need, and you could hear it and feel it in his voice, that I don't think anybody would have turned him away. And he's a different person now. He's got a smile on his face that, like everybody who knows him, they can see the smile in the back of his head. He radiates happiness now. Where before, he looked like he was always lost in some kind of thought, because there was something more that he wanted and he didn't know how to get there. And the devil had a stronger hold on his life through not, I don't want to blame him, but he did have his own free will, but he also, it started by what he was told to do by people who were in charge of him, basically. You know, when you're a little kid, you do what the doctor tells you to do. You do what your mother tells you to do. You do what your coaches tell you to do. And now God is telling him what to do. And he's hearing it and he's doing it. He's always been there for him, but he hears him stronger now than he ever did. And it was through Teen Challenge that he learned to hear him. This is a place where they can get help. Do everything you can do, if your child's not seeking it out themselves, to seek it out for them. Because sometimes we need to lead our children. And if we have to lead them all the way up there, we can't make them drink, but at least we can lead them. And hopefully God will hear you and they'll bend down and they'll drink. And they'll get something from it. Because I truly feel like my son is gonna win from this.
This is where all the guys stay. We got 24 beds here. And this right here is the common area where I myself and all my brothers spend a lot of time when we're not in classes or down eating or anything like that. This is where we spend most of our free time. We play chess a lot, you know, it's a tactical game. A game that reminds me of myself of spiritual warfare. And just for me, I know I take a long time before I make any kind of moves. And that's how I live my life. I check with God. I make sure that he wants me to move before I make a move. Because I have an enemy out there looking to take my king, looking to take my life. So I think chess is a pretty good game. It's a game that they allow us to play here, and I can kind of see the spiritual meaning here. There's a lot of spiritual meanings behind everything that we do here at Greater Piedmont Teen Challenge. It's an amazing place. Even the centerpiece here that pulls the room together. A picture of God, of a hand from heaven, reaching down through heaven, through the galaxy, down to earth, to take the hand of a man who seems to be living in darkness. You can't see it, but the world is cracked in this picture. In this dark world full of chaos. It's a beautiful piece. Splattered white spots signifying the blood that Jesus spilled on the cross for us. The blood that we ourselves need to grasp and take a hold of. To recognize that we are forgiven for our sins, that we are no longer living in condemnation, but we are set free through his blood. This dorm room, we have a kitchen here where we eat every day, 3 meals a day. Like I said before, 24 beds. This is a place of love, a place where I found peace, a place where I found God, where I had many revelations and where I broke down myself and God cleaned me out. I'll forever love this place. It holds a dear, a spot in my heart that I can't even express.
You may find it hard to believe that I was once a teenager myself. And I can relate actually to the struggles and the challenges that we face as a teen. Growing up's not easy. We're trying to fit in. And making those decisions in life about how we're going to fit in and who we're going to fit in with are often very, very challenging to us as a teen. And making good decisions by ourselves is very difficult. As a teen myself, I grew up with the church in my life for a certain period of time. But as I hit my teen years, things changed. My grandmother that I went to church with passed away. The church that I attended broke into two different groups due to some friction within that church. And it wasn't a very good time for a teen to have his church fall apart. It wasn't a good time for a teen to have his grandmother pass away either, that really was the guiding force that got him into church. But as these teen years came along, I've experienced all the challenges that the teens today still have. And my teenage years was 30 years ago, but the challenges are still the same as they were then. Alcohol, drugs, premarital sex. There are so many things that teens are forced with, or challenged with, rather. In my teen years, it was all about fitting in. You wanted to fit in with a certain group. You wanted to be with a certain group of people that if you didn't go along with the cool group, then you were cast away, or you were an outcast, or you were made fun of. So fitting in was always critical. I can remember the first experiences with alcohol. You know, that drinking was one of the primary things we had as a teen then. It was readily accessible. All you had to do back in the days was find an old bum back behind the Patrick Henry Mall, and you would and he would get you anything you wanted. Give him a couple of bucks and you had your Jack Daniels. And today I'm sure very similar situations are out there. But I can remember myself, my first experiences with alcohol were just drinking beer, and it graduated from, I can remember, going to a party, and the old moonshine was there, and I'd always seen my father turn up a fruit jar, and I figured I could turn up that fruit jar too. If Dad could do it, I could do it too. That first big weekend I had, when I had my driver's license for the very first Friday night, turned into a nightmare. I'd worked so hard to get that driver's license. And after one night of going out with my friends, I had friends that left with me, but at the end of the night, those friends were nowhere to be found. I had to try to make my way back home alone, intoxicated. By no means should have ever been behind the wheel. I can remember my car being running up the side of a hill, and somehow we got it back on the road. I can remember coming down Route 58 and hitting the curb in front of a gas station, but somehow we got it back on the road and made it home. But alcohol and drugs continued to play a role. They continued to grow in my life. Friends enticed me into smoking, trying marijuana for the first time at the age of 16. This became the cool thing to do. So me and the friends, you know, it was a weekend thing, and it went on for a while. But I could see that it was taken away from my focus on school. It was taken away from my success. I was a very smart kid in school. I was top of my class. But I smartened up. I decided to give up the marijuana, put it away. Senior year in school, got straightened out, put that away, got my grades back up, got back on the football team, and kept that out of my life. But at that age, when I turned 18, I was the first 18-year-olds in Virginia, the last 18-year-olds in Virginia to be legal to drink. So alcohol didn't leave my life. As I went on to college, drinking was a very, very prevalent thing. It was just a common thing, especially on the weekends, and if we didn't have a lot going on, weekdays as well. But even though that I had gotten away from marijuana, things returned in my life. It came back because there were people on my dormitory hall that I met that were smoking marijuana. And once again, did you want to fit in? Did you want to meet new friends? Did you want to make yourself acceptable to this group? So I returned to those ways. I went back to using smoking pot. And it was never something that I really let control my life. but I was able to still do these things, still function, still graduate. We spent through 4 years of college and was able to graduate. And after I got out of college, these habits still went with me. The drinking and the partying, the use of marijuana continued on. After my years, when I first got out of college, I wasn't very successful, didn't have a lot of money, didn't have a lot of spending money to put into to buying pot, but it was still, when we had an opportunity, and my friends, we would certainly try to get some, and we would still use it. But I ended up starting my own business. I didn't let these things deter me from success. As I said, you know, I tried to stay in control of these things, and I always felt that I was in control of these things. But often, as we do certain things in life, whether it's using alcohol as a recreational tool, just to fit in with friends, and it graduates from alcohol to marijuana, then it goes on to other drugs. Some people are pulled into pills. Some people are pulled into cocaine. Some people are pulled into other things that are out there. It's a completely different world than I faced 30 years ago as a teen. But as I went on this road of life, cocaine became a drug that I used. I was introduced to it by a friend. And it was one of those things. It was just a recreational thing to keep us going, to keep us partying. Hey, if we do this, we'll party all night long. And we become a slave to certain things, even though we may not use them on a daily basis. Maybe you're not truly addicted to it. You think you are in control, that yes, I can handle this. I can handle the alcohol. I can handle the drugs. I can handle anything that's thrown my way because I am in control. But when we become a slave to anything, when we become needy of a certain drug, no matter what it is, we long for it. I know in my life, although it wasn't a daily thing, come Friday night, come Saturday night, come Saturday morning sometimes, maybe all day Saturday, may have been focused on hanging out with the guys, partying and drinking and doing drugs. And believe me, sooner or later, these things are going to come back against you. They're going to haunt you. Although we may seem like we're in control, there's going to be bumps in the road, and there's going to be things that are going to happen that, although it may have seemed cool at the time, a stage in life is going to come about where it's not going to be cool anymore. The times I can remember, we can go back to days where, yeah, we were drinking, and you got drunk, you fell down, maybe you got sick, your friends laughed at you. You were the one they were laughing about and joking about come Monday. Oh boy, you fell down. Look how sick and stupid you were. You know what you said the other night? Boy, that was hilarious. Well, I wished I could remember it. Don't remember a thing. But there's a lot of things in my life that should have caused me to grow up a lot sooner. Having a family, getting married, should have changed things, should have made me see the light that I don't need these things in my life anymore. Probably one of the most painful things in my life is one of the friends that introduced me to cocaine died of a cocaine overdose. You would think that somebody that was your best friend, that was like a brother to you, the brother you never had, you would think that when he died, that it would be enough to make you change your mind and see that you didn't need these things in your life. But unfortunately for me, that I didn't. I felt that I had control of it. Well, he had an addiction. His problem was different than mine. I can put it away. He believed that you had to, if you had it, you did it, and you did it till it was all gone. Yeah, we're going to party all night, and that's it. Well, it eventually took his life. A very, very painful time, but it was a time that I should have seen and should have realized that it was time to grow up. But things go along in life, and we kept doing these things. kept walking down that road despite having a loving wife and a beautiful family. I kept these things hid from them, kept them out of my family life, and just kept them in my time. This was my time. When I got together with the guys to hang out and drink, you know, we could do whatever we wanted to as long as we weren't bothering anybody else. But you truly become a slave, as I said. You have a need. As I said, a lot of times when my Saturday rolled around, that's what I got up thinking about. I was got up thinking about when I was gonna have my first drink, when I was gonna have my first line of cocaine, when me and the guys were gonna get together and smoke our first joint. That was the things that would enter my mind. It was what I woke up on a Saturday morning saying, that's what I'm looking forward to that day. I should have been looking forward to spending time with my children, spending time with my daughters, doing things with them. I didn't think I was taking time away from them at the time. I still did things with them, but I can look back now and realize that the things that I was doing was taking time away from my family. It was taking quality time away. And I wish that I would have seen that sooner, because things in life change. And I must say that if we continue walking down that path, if we continue to go making our own decisions, making our decisions that we're in control and that we can handle anything that's out there for us, no matter whether it's alcohol, whether it's drugs, whether it's sex, whether it's pills, no matter what it is, the challenge that we're being faced at as a teen, it can go with you into your adult life. And I talked about growing up and that I should have grown up a long time ago. I should have grew up 20, 30 years ago. But I let my friends, the people around me, continue to influence them, looking for that approval, looking to fit in. And I must say that that road went on for a long time, walking in my decision, in man's eyes, doing what man wanted to do instead of what God wanted me to do. And unfortunately, it took God slapping me in my face very hard. When the local sheriff's department knocked on my door and took me away because of my involvement in drugs, it was a very, very helpless feeling. The feeling of control was completely gone.
If you have a friend or family member that is struggling with an addiction, here are 7 ways that you can help that person. First, follow Matthew 18:15-17 and Galatians 6:1-2. These scriptures are vital to your success. Second, find a Christian counselor or pastor for yourself and for them. Attempt to go to the counseling with them. They will need your support. Third, meet with your friends and family to pray and discuss options. Look into a teen challenge or other faith-based program that you could possibly enter them into to help break free from their addiction. Fourth, attempt an intervention for them with family and friends. Fifth, get legal assistance from the police and/or juvenile court services if they are a minor. Sixth, don't be afraid to press charges if necessary. This will only help them in the long run. And seventh, make sure that in every action you take, start with God's word. If you don't believe that you're strong enough or that you're ready to help them, at least make sure you're not enabling them in any way or you're contributing to their problem. Addiction is real. And as we've shown in this documentary, there is help available to those who want it. But for many, there are dire consequences. Don't allow yourself or a loved one to become a statistic about addiction.